Good morning. Good morning and welcome to the First Congregational Church of Lebanon, Connecticut, to our virtual Sunday morning service. If this is the first time that you have stumbled upon our service, you are welcome. If this is a usual thing for you to do, then welcome again on this beautiful day. I am recording this early, of course, but hopefully this will be also a beautiful day on Sunday. Today being Mother's Day, I would love to tell every mother Happy Mother's Day, whether you are birthed your own children or you have mothered other people's children, you are an aunt, a sister, a wife, anyone who is mothered anyone, Happy Mother's Day to you. And now, hopefully, you will enjoy our service. They have been wonderful, and we welcome you here today with us. And now, wondering if there are any other announcements.
Church is canceled due to snow? Obviously, I'm kidding. There aren't really any announcements for today, but obviously Dawn didn't know that when she recorded her video. She also didn't know it was gonna snow. So, good morning. I guess just really quick, if you do want to get me any names for next week's service of essential workers, please have those to me by Thursday. Other than that, keep doing what you're doing. If you're enjoying our service, share it with a friend, share it with a family member, along with any of the other videos that get posted to Facebook and YouTube. We're reaching a whole lot of people. It's really, really cool. I'm really excited. I'm really proud of everything that we're doing. And I hope you guys are too. All right, I'll see you soon. Bye.
And now I would like to turn the service over to Reverend Will.
And Jesus said, "Come." To all mothers and all children, he said, "Come." To the motherless and the childless, he said, "Come." To all who longed to be mothered, he said, "Come. Come unto me, all ye who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble of heart, and you will find rest for your souls." Welcome. Happy Mother's Day. I'm glad that you're here. I pray that you find comfort and peace in our worship service today. Good morning.
Good morning, everyone. I want to say Happy Mother's Day to all the moms, and I want to especially say Happy Mother's Day to my mom, Evelyn Graber. I love you, Mom. Happy Mother's Day. And from both Mom and I, we send our love and our hugs to all of you. We miss you. We look forward to the time when we can gather in our sanctuary again. Until then, stay safe and make it a great day.
Hi, Mom. I just wanted to wish you a happy Mother's Day for me and your new little grand doggy. I hope you have a great day. Miss you so much. I love you.
Hi, Mom. Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day to my mom, and Happy Mother's Day to the first mate, and Happy Mother's Day to all moms watching. You are all special, and you are all loved.
I'd like to wish my mom in Florida and my mother-in-law in Massachusetts a Happy Mother's Day. Love you guys, and miss you.
Happy Mother's Day, Noreen. Happy Mother's Day, Nani.
Hi, Mom. Happy Mother's Day. Thank you for everything you've done for us. Happy Mother's Day. We love you.
I think it's recording. Okay. I don't know if I'll be able to use this, but we'll see. Ready? 3, 2, 1. Happy Mother's Day. Quiet. Where did it go?
Happy Mother's Day to all the moms in our church. And a big thanks to our mom. We love you.
Bye. Thank you.
gathered in the presence of the God in whom every family in heaven and on earth receives its name. We come in the prayer that the peace of Christ might dwell in our family relationships. We come in the prayer that the peace of God might permeate in the life of the human family. May the love of Christ fill our hearts, our lives, and our world. To the glory of God. Amen.
Children praise you for all the gifts of your grace. We thank you for those who are our partners in the adventure of living. We thank you for Jesus Christ, who in serving love gave all human partnerships new meaning. And since without your help we can do nothing as we ought, we pray you to enrich us with your grace, that we may be faithful and loving in all our relationships, through the Spirit of Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Aftershock. The day you were born was like an earthquake. The landscape that was my life was jostled and shifted and fractured to expose new life. Through a baptism of pain and joy, you were born. Into a landscape forever transformed by your being here. Children are like that. I am the epicenter of your life, and you will be feeling the aftershocks of my love for the rest of your life. My voices will blow through your consciousness like a murmuring wind. You will curse them, ignore them, cherish them, and someday even come to need them. And they will be there for you, even when I am not. Earthquakes are like that. They are fierce and powerful and always life-altering. They reverberate and resonate far from their source and long afterwards. A mother's love is like that. Brace yourself.
Without any words. Mary.
Good morning, boys and girls. I thought that we had such a lovely service last week where we celebrated Earth Day that I would do the children's message outside again this week. So I want you to remember, last week in our Zoom Sunday school, we talked about the first churches, and we talked about how they started with the apostles and the first Christians, and how they met as groups in people's homes, and they prayed together, and they shared meals, and they shared their time together. And they even shared whatever they had to help others in their community. This morning, I want to share a little bit about one of the first Christians named Stephen. In the early days of the church, the Christians shared and pooled their resources within their community. A high priority was for the community to provide for the widows and the orphans. They would distribute food from the community collection, but sometimes this led to a problem because some of the people were getting more of the food than others. To help with this, the apostles called for 7 men of good character to be elected as deacons, and they would take over the food distribution. Stephen was one of these first deacons. He was especially gifted, and he stood out above all the others. He was just one of those people who seemed to have it all together. He was smart, he had a warm heart, he got along with almost everyone. He seemed at ease in every situation. I'm sure you know people like this, people that it seems like everything just comes easy to them. They always make good grades. They don't even seem to have to study a lot. They are really good at every sport. They can draw, they can dance, they can sing beautifully. Stephen was one of these people. He showed great promise of being one of the best. The important thing for us to learn and remember from Stephen is that we have great responsibility for how we use our talents. Jesus taught us that we should use them for service. Stephen knew this, which is why he took his job as deacon so seriously in distributing food and caring for the widows, the orphans, the poor, the needy, the homebound, and even the dying. In Sunday school last week, we talked about how we are the church, the people that work together, that play together, that have a fun time together. That's what the church is. The church is not the building that we meet in. Even now, when we are all having to stay home and we cannot be together in the same building, our church is still working very strong together to help and care for each other. We are following in Stephen's example. We are cooking meals for each other. We are checking in on each other by making phone calls, stopping by people's houses to wave goodbye for birthday greetings. We are sending in, waving good morning to each other for virtual worship services. For those of us who can play the guitar or sing songs, we're recording so that we can share our gift and talent of music with each other. I can even think of one talent, which some people might not think of, but that is to just have strong technology skills. And I send a big shout out to Teresa, who spends every week compiling all of our recordings so that we can have such a wonderful virtual worship service. So again, the point is, whatever your gift is, that gift came from God, and it should be used to help others. God invites us, and Jesus taught us how to show God's compassionate love and how to work together to form a stronger community. So I challenge you, boys and girls, to think about what gifts and talents God has given you and how you can use them to care for others. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you for our church community, and we ask that you help us to grow closer to each other and closer to you. God, we thank you for the towns where we live, and we ask that you help us to spread your love to our friends and our neighbors. We express our gratitude and thankfulness for all of our church community who have helped to make this community be strong and to thrive. Help us to remember that we would not be a community were it not for all of our service to one another. Fill us with your Spirit today, so that we can reflect your love to each other and to the world. Amen.
Time now for the Church at Prayer. I recognize that there are many, many folks that we need to remember in our prayers, all of the essential workers and frontline workers, and certainly our loved ones that we're not able to be with or be physically present to at this time. So I invite you to lift those folks in prayer. But This morning, I'd like to offer a special Mother's Day prayer, and we'll follow that with the Lord's Prayer. So let us join together now, and let us be in the spirit of prayer. And let us pray. Loving God, we give thanks today for mothers. Thank you for mothers who gave birth to us, and women who have treated us as their own children. You teach us how to be good mothers, cherishing and protecting the children among us. Help us mother lovingly, fairly, wisely, and with great joy. Help us raise our children to be the people they are born to be. We need your comfort today, God, because some are missing mothers. Some are missing children. Some are parted by distance or death. Some are separated by social distancing guidelines. Give comfort to those who want to be close but can't. Comfort those who have given up their child for adoption or who choose not to give birth. Comfort those who longed to be biological mothers and could not. We pray for those whose mothers have disappointed them, and we ask for grace in relationships where there is pain and bitterness, for healing in relationships where there is abuse and violence. Help our church to be a space where people can feel mothered, their gifts and their talents appreciated and nurtured. And finally, we pray today for mothers around the world, mothers who cannot feed their children, mothers who are homeless or without a homeland, mothers who must teach their children about the dangers of bombs and bullets. Help us create a world where mothers can raise their children in peace and plenty. And God of mothers, who created mothers, who came as a child and had a mother, God our mother, loving us with a sweeter and deeper love than we have ever known, hear our prayer this day. And all of this we ask in the name of Jesus, who may have taught his disciples to pray. Our Mother, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Mother's Love, Helen Steiner Rice. A mother's love is something that no one can explain. It is made of deep devotion and of sacrifice and pain. It is endless and unselfish and enduring come what may, for nothing can destroy it or take that love away. It is patient and forgiving when all others are forsaking, and it never fails or falters, even though the heart is breaking. It believes beyond believing when the world around condemns, and it glows with all the beauty of the rarest, brightest gems. It is far beyond defining, it defies all explanation, and it still remains a secret like the mysteries of creation. A May-splendored miracle man cannot understand, and another wondrous evidence of God's tender, guiding hand, a mother's love.
Today's scripture reading is from Acts
chapter 7, verses 55 through 60, the stoning of Stephen. But filled with the Holy Spirit, he gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. Look, he said, I see the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. But they covered their ears, and with a loud shout, all rushed together against him. Then they dragged him out of the city and began to stone him, and the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. While they were stoning Stephen, he prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then he knelt down and cried out in a loud voice, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. When he had said this, he died. Here ends today's reading.
Do you remember your mom saying, people in glass houses don't throw stones? Well, mom was wrong, because they do. They're just really careful not to throw them in the direction of their own house. And what mom meant was that is if your life is on display, you probably won't be so quick to judge. And once again, mom was wrong, because people are quick to judge. Yeah, no matter where they live. But before you throw stones, be sure that you know what was written on those stones. So I read this story about this young mother, and she was in high school when she realized that she was pregnant. And the relationship that she had with her mom was already rocky, and certainly this wasn't gonna help. Her mom did get upset. And the mom and the daughter, they went over the options, and the option that seemed to make the most sense to them was adoption. So she would deliver the baby, and then she would hand the baby over to new parents. And so while all of her friends were busy choosing colleges, she was busy choosing the parents for her child. And the girl's mother refused to have anything to do with this mess. But when the time came for the baby to be brought into the world, things seemed most ordinary. And the young mother handed the baby over to her mother. And so for 2 hours while the teenager rested, the grandmother bonded with her new grandchild. And when those 2 hours were over, nobody was going to pry that baby out of the grandmother's arms. And also, the mother of the baby came to the realization that she couldn't let this baby out of her life. So while other teenagers, they were going to proms and movies and colleges, this young mother was doing midnight feedings, changing diapers, visiting the pediatrician. Did she regret her decision? Yeah, there were probably times that she did. And was she judged by her decision? Most definitely. And she still questions whether she's doing the right thing for her child. She could have given the baby to a family with a six-figure income and 4 bedrooms out in the suburbs. Instead, she's giving that baby the best gift that she can give. She's giving that baby a mother's love. So be mindful when you see a young mother pushing a stroller. Don't throw stones, because those stones just may say a mother's love. 3 years ago, on May 11th, there was an incident that received national attention, and the video went viral. Vice President Mike Pence was taking advantage of a press opportunity while surrounded by children. Now, while delivering the speech, he inadvertently brushed the face of a young man while waving his arm. And it was all completely innocent, and there was no malice intended. And watching the video, it hardly looks like anything at all. However, the young boy winces and says, ouch. The speech ends, and the vice president turns toward the children and he gives them hugs. However, the boy who was bopped in the face demands an apology. It's really quite sweet. Three times, he stands behind the well-dressed adult saying, "Excuse me." And then he says to the silver-haired, grandfatherly adult, "You owe me an apology." Now, this was turned into a fiasco. Both sides of the political world were using this story to advance their agenda. Both sides picked up stones and were ready to whip them across the aisle. And there is Stephen. He's standing alone. He has preached the gospel. He has shared what is his truth. And those who were present, they covered their ears. They didn't want to hear his truth. They weren't even open to the possibility that Stephen was right. And they had stones in their hands, and they were locked and loaded. See, Stephen was the chair of the original Mission and Outreach Committee. The apostles realized the needs of the people were too great, and so they formed a committee of 7 members, and Stephen was to be in charge. And Stephen was a man full of God's grace and power, and he did wonders and miraculous signs. And then, of course, opposition arose. And when the opposition, they didn't get their way, they went deeper. And then they brought against him false accusations, and they stirred up the people against him. And because they still didn't get their way, they went to the oldest trick in the book. They discredit the accused. Stephen was called before the Sanhedrin, which was the highest council for the Jews. And Stephen offers his defense in a short but detailed history of his people. However, Stephen might have gone too far because he accused the Jewish elders of being stubborn and mean. And he even blames them for the betrayal and murder of the Messiah. And how do they respond? They drag Stephen out of the hearing, and then they stone him to death. But before he dies, he is able to cry out in a loud voice, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." So at the same time, Stephen accuses them and forgives them. He calls them out, and he's asking God to forgive them. He's begging for their forgiveness. So while their stones have written on them blasphemy, heretic, sinner, the only stone that Stephen can throw back, a single small stone he can throw in his accuser's direction, says on one side, "Forgive." And on the other side, it says, "Love." A young boy named Michael gets to go to Washington, D.C. with his mother and his brother. Now, Michael's father couldn't go, couldn't be there on that trip because he serves in the military and was deployed at the time. Now, Michael's mother, well, she holds a PhD. She's a clinical and research psychologist, a founder at the Military Spouse Behavioral Health Clinicians. And this mom is a fierce advocate for the mental health of our soldiers and their spouses. And these are some of the reasons why she was named a Military Spouse of the Year. Michael calls the White House the People's House, and he's surrounded by other children of those serving in the military. He's there with his peers, but they're not like Mikey. He gets to meet Ivanka Trump and others who he doesn't know, but they must be famous. Michael is one of many who are gathered around the podium for a media-friendly photo opportunity. Michael, to use the vice president's word, gets bopped in the face. And three times in his sweet, innocent voice, he speaks his truth. And then an 8-year-old boy calls out to the second most powerful man in the country, "You owe me an apology." Now, how many times have you wished you said something like that? How many times have you been on the receiving end of something that you didn't ask for and you wish that you had asked for an apology? How many times have you walked away from something or somebody muttering to yourself and later regretting not speaking your truth? How many minutes of sleep have you lost thinking about those regrets? Things that you wish you had said, things that you wish you had the courage to say. See, this was meant to be a cute photo op showing the softer side of the White House. And the vice president is even seen as asking the kids if he can give them a hug. And the cameras are locked and loaded, and the film is shot. Now, Michael has been both honored and vilified in the press. But here's the thing. He's just a kid. Mikey's a kid who was used for a political photo op. Now, he's a boy that was raised right by his mother, probably wrestled with his brothers in the back seat of the car, and each time that one of them went too far, they had to apologize to the others. He loves dinosaurs, his family, his country, the military, and even the People's House. And I'm pretty sure that the kid has a fondness for the vice president as well, because once he realized what he did apologize. The political pundits, the talking heads, the late night show hosts, they polished up their stones, because they each had to throw their stones from different angles. And some of those stones had written on them, "Hero." Some said, "Snowflake." Some think the stone said, "Victim." From the other side, a stone says, "Safe space" or "Needy." Some even wrote on their stones, "Stalker." Now, those watching the video footage might think that the only stones that Michael threw said, "Ouch." Or even three small stones that said, "Excuse me." The last stone he held on to said, "You owe me an apology." Stephen had a voice, and he used it. When people didn't like what he was saying, they threw rocks at him. They meant to silence him. They threw rocks at him to keep him quiet. They threw rocks at him so that his voice would be heard no more. But it didn't work. The last words of Stephen were the most polite words ever recorded in history. "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." There are a few more things about Michael that you should know. There is one more stone in his arsenal. See, he's on the autism spectrum. For years, because of his autism, Mikey was nonverbal. And though his autism robbed him of his voice for so long, he was able to confidently hold a conversation with the Vice President of the United States of America in the White House. In the process, he taught more than a few of us a lesson or two in manners and respect and personal boundaries. And he also taught us that no matter who you are, you have a voice. And you should be heard. The stoning of Stephen went viral. People who witnessed the most polite thing ever said to the most powerful people in their world in the face of crushing adversity, it inspired them. Stephen's words of love and respect made a lasting impression. I mean, they made an impression certainly on a young man who was there. Saul was a member of the High Council, and while we don't know if Saul was one of the folks who hurled a rock, we know that he was a witness. And Saul would forever remember that day. Later, Saul changed his name to Paul. He became a fierce advocate for the church. And one can't help but read all of Paul's letters in the Bible and know that the polite words of Stephen inspired the spreading of the gospel and was the impetus for the church. There are those with stones trying to bring Michael down. He's a snowflake child. He's stalking the vice president for an apology. He needs a safe space. He probably learned all this apology stuff at home. Yes, and yes, he does need a safe space. And he did learn this apology stuff at home. He's relentless in demanding an apology because he learned those things from his mother, who adores him and is largely the one responsible for raising him, because his father is deployed in the defense of our country. See, Mikey's family has chosen to make certain sacrifices. Parents make sacrifices all the time for their children. A pastor tells a story about when he was coming home from a mission trip in Haiti, and a woman came up to her carrying her baby. And she began to plead with the minister, "Please, take my baby. Take my baby. If you don't take him, my baby's going to die. Please take him." And the minister, he tried everything that he could to dissuade her. But certainly he couldn't take her baby. But yet she kept repeating, "Please, take my baby. Take my baby." And the minister, he ran to the plane. And the mother ran after him, crying, "Please take my baby. If you take him, he will live." She is absolute in her desire to have the man take her baby, to take her child. She cared more about that child than her own feelings. She was willing to give up her baby so that her baby could live. She was willing to take her chances on the world rather than knowing that that baby, if it stayed with her, that her baby would die. She was willing to make that sacrifice. See, parents, they're supposed to make sacrifices. A mother's love is a sacrifice that she is willing to make again and again and again, but she will never see it as a sacrifice. She is simply a mother who's doing what a mother does. Jesus famously said, "Let he who is without sin cast the first stone." And Mom famously said, "If you don't have anything nice to say, well, you can finish the rest." However, if you do have something nice to say, then claim your voice and speak your truth. If you've got something to say, claim your voice, speak your truth. People may reject you. They might reject you, but if you say it with love, if you say it with love, then the sacrifice is always worth it. The sacrifice is always worth it. Amen.
Oh,
Knowing that you are embraced by the love of God, a love that is sweeter and more tender than any that you have ever known. Amen.